ברשות מורי ורבותיי, with the permission of Hashem, שבוע טוב, have a good week. This week, Be'ez Hashem, is Purim. We know Purim, we do Purim to remember the biggest Shoah that the Jews nearly had. The Haman, he decided to kill the Jews, but not a simple pogrom, not a simple immediate killing, but he wanted to kill the whole Jews, wherever they are. The student of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai, they ask the rabbi, what it is the reason that Hashem, he wanted to kill the whole Jews? What it is the reason that Haman, he decided to kill the whole Jews? It's not, of course, you must understand that it was the biggest Shoah of all time. That means, if Haman would kill the Jews, it will be the end of the Jews, because there is a big difference between what Hitler wanted to do to the Jews and Haman. Because Hitler, even if he found the solution to kill the whole Jews here in Europe, but still the Jews in America remain, Australia, Morocco, well, there is some in Africa. Well, he couldn't kill the whole Jews. I mean, he could kill a few millions as he did, but not the whole Jews. Nearly, you know, in Europa, it nearly finished the Jews in Europa, but not in Africa, not in the North America, in the South America. You know, he did not do it because he couldn't. Maybe if God forbid, if he would beat America, so he could do everything. But at least, at that time, America was a strong nation, so it was not possible that he could do the last solution for the Jews to kill them. Okay, but now we have a big problem. The problem that we have today is this week is Purim. And why we do Purim? Because of Haman. He wanted to kill the Jews, and Baruch Hashem, this bad Gezerah was stopped by Mordechai and Esther, and Hashem, he helped the Jews at the time not to die. Baruch Hashem. But the student of Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai asked him why. What it is the reason? I mean, that a man decide to kill the whole Jews, to finish with them, it must be a reason. So what it is the reason? So Rabbi Shimon Bar Yochai told them the reason is because shinehnu misaudato shel oto rasha, because they accepted the invitation of Achashverosh. As you know, Achashverosh decided to do a big party, a party not for one day party, for a few days parties, big party. And he invited all nations to come, to eat, to drink, to enjoy themselves. And the Jews came as well. Now, you must know that the food that the Jews eat, it was a kosher, huh? It was a glot kosher. It wasn't just a food, just a normal food. No, it was a good food. That means that the Jews, they are not mad. They will not eat not kosher food. And of course, Achashverosh, he knows the Jews could have a problem with them, because the Jews, they were in exile there, and they did a big teshuvah, and of course they will not eat something that is not kosher. Besides, you know, that the Beit HaMikdash, the first temple, was destroyed. And why it was destroyed? Because they did not respect Torah and Mitzvot. And now they were in exile. And you know, the exile should long 70 years. Now it's nearly 70 years over. And now they were preparing to go back to Israel, to Jerusalem, to build the second temple. So don't think that Achashverosh is mad to force the Jews to eat not kosher food. No. So of course the food was kosher. Then, you know, and it said in the Megillah that Achashverosh, he decided that any kind of hashgacha, any kind of food you want, you can receive it. Any kind of drink you want, you can have it. He was very, very, very rich. And he wanted to make, he wanted to show people his wealth, his everything. He wanted to show the Jews, to everybody, everything. So because he was the most powerful man in the world at that time. Now you can imagine, Haman, he could finish with the whole Jews if he wanted. Because Haman, he was governing 127 nations. That means the whole world. That means that really he could kill the whole Jews if he wanted. And he did want. Only Hashem stopped him. As I said, there is a difference between Hitler and Haman. Hitler, he couldn't finish with the whole Jews. Anyway, some Jews will remain. But with Haman, it was the end. Haman could finish all of them. So the question is, why Hashem, he decided to bring this kind of gezerah on the Jews? So Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai said, because the Jews, they accepted the invitation of Achashverosh. And they want to eat. And because they want to eat, and they talk a pleasure to eat, and that those festivities, so Hashem decided to frighten them between you and me. Don't think Hashem will kill the Jews, but he wanted to push them to do Teshuvah. A lot of times today, even today, a lot of people, they do Teshuvah, they come back to God, to Hashem, because they are ill, they are not well, they have a problem. Thousands of people, I knew thousands of people, they did Teshuvah because of a problem. Because of a problem. Even me, when I have a big problem, I do Teshuvah. I do more Teshuvah. I do more. I ask Hashem, believe in Hashem. A lot of people that they did not believe in Hashem at all. And because of a problem that they had, they started to think. They saw that there is no problem, there is no solution. So, Baruch Hashem, they find a way, Hashem. Hashem is always the last address. I would like just to tell you a story, a beautiful story, a fabulous story. You know, this week in France, there was a man, a very well-known man. It's a famous story. A very well-known man. And this man, he, unfortunately, with the stock market, what happened the last 2 years, he lost a lot of money. And his house, he has a nice house. He has as well a mortgage, because he needs to make a big loan. And he put his house in a mortgage to survive. The crisis. And unfortunately, the bank decided 6 months ago, if he doesn't pay the mortgage, they will take the house. And of course, he came. He came to see me a few times. And unfortunately, nothing happened. And what happened is that he received a letter on Shabbat, on Saturday, last Saturday. That Shabbat, from the bank. They told him that he has to leave the house open house, because people will start to come to visit his house. Because they're going to sell it on this Thursday, an auction. So the poor man, he came to see me on Sunday, last Sunday, and he was crying. He said, I have no life anymore. People come, they see the house, they visit the house, and I have a problem with my wife. My wife, she don't understand why. And please, Rabbi David, can you do something for us? Pray to Hashem. I said, well, of course I pray for you, but now, all what you need is, I think maybe you need to pray more. Maybe you have to take more on you. Maybe do more mitzvot. Maybe you have to study Torah. a little bit more of Torah. And this is, you have no choice. This is what you should do. And he said, but I do everything. I said, well, maybe you have to do more. Maybe Hashem wants you to do more. Maybe you have to pay all what you didn't do before, because when you had a lot of business, when you were rich, you did not have time to study Torah, you didn't have to pray. Maybe now that you have, you don't work as much as you worked before, maybe now you have to pay. You have to pay to Hashem what you owe him. You owe him time. Time, maybe that's what you should do. And he looked at me and said, but you know, I have only a few days. This is Sunday. It's on Thursday. I said, well, this is for today. It's Thursday. Hashem, you can do a lot of things. He said, but Rabbi David, from where? It's already 6 months. I knocked at all doors to try to find something. There is nothing. So please, what can I do? Bemet, I did not know what to tell him. I was a little bit very, very sad for him. Not a little bit, I was very sad because I know him. He was a big Baal Tzedakah, and he was a good man, very well man here in France, in Paris. Very big family. And unfortunately, nobody wanted to help him. It's like everybody forgot what he did before, all the good things he did. Unfortunately, you know, I want to tell you something. Never rely on people. Always have faith on Hashem. Because no one can help you when you have a problem. Only HaKadosh Baruch Hu, only Hashem. A lot of times we think that when I have a problem, I have a lot of friends who will help me. There is no friends. When you have a problem, there is no friends. There is your friends only when everything is okay. But when we have problems, you will find yourself with no friends. Maybe we have one or two, but not as many as you know. It's impossible. I know. A lot of times, even me, I have money problems, and sometimes I know that I will embarrass people if I ask them alone, because maybe they will tell me no, maybe I will not see them anymore. So I prefer not to ask them, and I ask to Hashem. That's what David HaMelech said. Arur HaGever Ashir Iftah Ba'adam. A man, he should be cursed if he relies on another man. We're not allowed. We're not allowed. Baruch HaGeber, bless a man who relies on Hashem. Because only Hashem can give you. Only Hashem can do. But how we can do? When you have emunah, when you pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. So that's what he did. So I told him, now maybe you have a loan with Hashem. Maybe you didn't pay Hashem back all what he did for you. So now maybe you have to do more Torah mitzvot. So he said, but Rabbi, I have only one. I said, well, a week. A week is a week. Maybe in a week there is a lot of things you can do. In a week, Hashem, he can help you. So the story was, for me, was over. But I was a little bit sad for him. On Thursday afternoon, I was thinking, well, what happened to that man with the auction, with the house auction? People wanted to, they were all invited to buy his house in auction. The most important is that the bank wanted the mortgage, 400,000 euro mortgage. So for the bank, they don't care how much they sell the house. For the bank, they want the money. That's it. So of course, there were 100 people because the house cost over a million euro. So people were there, they came. And of course, David HaMelech said, when a man has a problem, David HaMelech said, when I have a problem, I lift my eyes to Hashem. And I ask Hashem, from where my solutions will come? And David HaMelech answered, Me'ayin Yavo Ezri, from nowhere, from nothing, Hashem can help you. From what you don't expect to get the help, from there, you will get the help. Hashem has millions of ways. Millions of ways. Don't worry, Hashem is the Baal HaBayit. So what happened? It happened that when on Thursday he went, because he has to sign to the one who's going to buy the house. So he went, everybody was crying with his wife, and his lawyer was with him. And his lawyer asked him, "Well, mister, what are you going to do now?" He said, "Well, it's finished. I did pray to Hashem, and Hashem, maybe he doesn't want to help me for some reasons that I don't know, but I will not lose my hope on Hashem even if I lose this house." The lawyer looked at him, his lawyer. He told him, "You know, I didn't sleep all night. I was thinking of you." And he put his hand in his pocket. And he took from his pocket a check, checkbook. He told him, "You need exactly 430,000 euro to pay the bank. So you will not lose your house. Here's the money. Here's the check. We're gonna pay now before the auction starts. Pay the bank. That's it." He was shocked at the Jew. He said, "You, my lawyer, I owe you 25,000 euros. You're supposed to be the first one to get paid from that money. And you help me." He said, "Yes." This is Hashem. You see? The same story of the Jews. And the man, he accepted the check, of course, and he paid the bank. And the bank, they couldn't understand what happened. This is Hashem. That's exactly what happened to the Jews. They saw Haman so angry against them. He wanted to kill them. He wanted to finish with them, all of them. And everything was ready. Letters were sent to everywhere to get prepared. So the 14th of Adar, all non-Jews can kill the Jews and take their money. And everywhere they were ready, prepared. Just they waited for the date to come. Look how the situation changed. The one who wanted to kill the Jews, he got hanged. Everything was changed. Big miracle happened to the Jews. That's why we do Purim. V'na'afuchu. It's the contrary. It's the opposite. Instead of the non-Jews kill the Jews, so the Jews, all those people who prepared themselves to kill them, they got punished. Haman and his children were hanged, and Mordechai, he took his place. He became the second after the king Ahasuerus. It's amazing. But what it's incredible is the Jews, they did not steal money from nobody. They did not take money from nobody. Now that the Jews they heard that the queen, she's Jewish, Esther, and now Mordechai, the Jew, the head of the Jews, he become the second after the king, and Ahasuerus become very friendly to the Jews. Now they could do whatever they wanted to do, but they did nothing. For them, the happiness is, "Thank you, Hashem, that you protect us." Because it was unexpected. Who knows? Nobody knew that Esther, she was the queen. And suddenly, everything changed. A miracle. When you have bitachon on Hashem, when you rely on Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu can help you from where you think, from there you will not get nothing, from there we'll get something. It's all up to you. This is Hashem, because he's the Baal HaBayis, he's the boss. Hashem can do anything. He made the Jews cross the sea. The Jews arrived to the sea when they left Egypt. And the sea was in front of them. And they had them, the Egyptians with Paro were coming to get them, back to Egypt. And there was nowhere to go. And Hashem is to Moshe, tell them to go ahead. Where? Ahead. But ahead it's the sea. It's Yam Suf. It's very, 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 very... it was crazy to enter the sea. It's so deep. You know, Yam Suf is very well, it's very, very deep. And Hashem said, tell them to go. And when they started to cross to enter the sea splashed. And they crossed the sea. This is Hashem. I know it happened to me millions of miracles in my life. From the unexpected, my help came. But always when I have emunah on Hashem. But if Hashem Shalom, I rely on people, I lose. So Hashem, I have a good friend. Hashem. He is my friend. Adonai Ro'e Lo Yechsar. When you decide that Hashem, He is your boss, you will need nothing. But if you decide that you can make it, your friend will help you to make it, you will lose. You will lose. So my friend, our question is, because the Jews, they accepted the invitation of Paro, of Hashverosh, they have to be punished. Understand if they eat not kosher food, okay. Understand if they eat chazer, the pig, or if they eat, you know, basar v'chala, meat and butter and cheese. Understand? Hashem could punish, but they eat kosher food. What the problem? What the problem? Of course, Akash Re would say to scare them, but why to scare them like this? But at the time, they did not know that Hashem was scaring them. For them, it was really, it was finished. It was a totally destruction of the Jews. He decided to finish the soul, his face. He hit them, Haman. He couldn't stand the Jews. Finish, Amalek, Haman. Can you see Hitler, the way he hit the Jews? So Haman was millions of times more than him. Why? Why Hashem he did that to the Jews? Why? Baruch Hashem, it did not happen, but why to scare them? You know, my friend, what it is the reason? Because Hashem, He wants us to know one thing. Always to make sure that always we should be behind Him. I would excuse me if I tell you this. You should know this. It's not Hash V'Shalom, God forbid, I want to scare you. It just, you should know that in life it's not easy to be Jew. And it's easy to lose the Judaism. When we start losing Judaism, God forbid, it could be worse for the children. And then the godchildren, they could be totally finished. They will mix with others, and then it's assimilation. That's it. Finished. We've been, for thousands of years, we've been fighting to keep our Judaism. We should not lose it. And there is rules how not to lose it. Because it's so easy to lose it. So easy to lose it. You know, today with the technology, with the internet, with all this advanced technology of today, It's easy to lose to Judaism. You know how many people, how many thousands of families they are finished? Why? Because, of course, the internet is good, but you should know how to use it. But unfortunately people, there's some people that they see things that it should not see. And like a married woman or a married man, if he sees and tells something that he should not see, and he catches his wife watching something that it's bad, it's divorce. I know a lot of families, they've been destroyed because of this. Today, you must be strong. You have to be very strong in mind. And you have to keep, really, have a lot of faith in Hashem. To keep Torah and Mitzvot. Maybe, through this, you can keep well your Judaism on you. Because it's easy to say I'm Jew. It's not easy. Very hard, very, very hard. Very hard. Of course, I'm not asking you to be all of you rabbis like me. No. No one can be a rabbi like me because it's not easy. It's very hard to be a rabbi. But at least, of course, you have to work, you can work, you can eat, you can enjoy yourself. But in a kosher way. A lot of times people did not see what it is a kosher way. Well, my lecture of today is not how to find the kosher way. But at least you know. You learn. You learn. It's not easy. I would like just to tell you a little story. One day I was in the plane. Two things I want to tell you. One day I was in the plane and I was writing. And I wanted to have a glass of water. So I asked the steward to bring me a glass of water. And she bring me a glass of water, but she was holding the glass like that. It's a small glass. So I was thinking, from where I'm going to hold the glass? Because anywhere the glass, I will have, maybe I have to touch her. Maybe for me it's nothing, but for me it's something. For me, I can't. I'm a rabbi. I fight my etzara, and I have to fight. Don't think I am a tzaddik. I am a man, like everybody. So suddenly I had to answer. In 1 minute, in 1 second, I had to give her an answer. Thank you very much. I'm sorry, I'm not thirsty anymore. She was, okay, thank you. If you need, you are call me. Then what she did? She came, she put it back. She said, anyway, if you want to drink, you can drink. I said, thank you, Hashem. Oh, Hashem, you must find a way how to fight. You must find a way. See, there's something. One day, again, I was in the plane again. And I was writing, I was studying Torah. And they brought me my kosher food. So I opened it. And then she brings the hot meal, and I was writing, and suddenly after 5-10 minutes she came back, she said, did you eat? I said, no. We're sorry. That's not yours, this is yours. We switch it. This is the kosher. I said, thank you, madam. Now take everything I don't want to eat. And I said, thank you to Hashem. When Hashem is see that you want to keep your Judaism, He help you. But if he sees that you don't care, so he lets you do what you want. If I care, because, I mean, I don't want to do any fault or purpose. And Hashem knows that I want to do things right. So Hashem, he knows. Hashem, when he sees that I do things right, to help me. But if Hashem, he sees that I don't do things right, so it will not help me. It's up to me. It's all up to me. My friend, now you understand. Ahasuerus, the king of Persia, he invited the whole world to come to his party. Not a one day party, a few days party, a big party. And everything was an abundance. Just come eat, enjoy yourself. The Jews, they were invited as well. But as you know, the Jews, they should go there, okay, for half an hour, just to show the king that we're not fighting, we're not against you, we respect you, here we are, we came, that's it, and go. But to come every day, to sit every day, to eat every day, to enjoy themselves every day, that was not right. Because through those parties that they were, the food was kosher, but the rest of the party was not kosher. What it is the proof? The proof that Ahasuerus, one day, he said to his wife, Vashti, come and dance in front of everybody. And he asked her to come nude, with no clothes on. Can you imagine that? And the Jews were there. Okay, she did not come. Because it was a revolution for her. She was very angry. How can my husband ask me to come nude in front of everybody? She was not happy for that. But as you know, my friend, this is a big problem. This is a big problem. Why they stay there? Why they remain there? I mean, can you imagine? This is how people get used to bad things. The first day, they do something, they attend to something, and then the second day, they do it, and after, they do, after the, it's got worse and worse, and then after they can eat tariff, not kosher. The Satan, he will not come to see me, he will not push me to look at a woman. Because he now will not do it. But he has a way how to do it. He has ways, he has millions of ways how he can push me one day to look at a woman or to do a big sin. Only by increasing when the day starts, it doesn't start with sunshine, you know, it starts with a little bit of light, the dark starts to go, and then after you have the moon, the sun, it's flashing. But the beginning started little by little. This is the way how the Tzara act with people. At the first time, he would not ask me do a big sin. No, little by little. Today the Jews, they were invited by Ahasuerus. They started to eat. They remained the first day. Then the second day, they came again. They came for. And the more they came, the more they got pleasures. And then they started to let the Judaism behind. Instead of going to the Beit HaMidrash, going to pray, they did quick tefillah, quick pray, just to go to the party. So Hashem, we said, this is the way you start. This is the way you prepare for the construction, the build of the second temple. This is the way. If Hashem would not do what he did to frighten them, to scare them, maybe no one will go to Eretz Israel to build the temple, the second temple. Maybe it will be all of them assimilated. So Hashem, he had to stop it. Stop. To get them back to him. This is how Hashem, he gets back, he brings back the Jews back to him. This is the way he acts. And Baruch Hashem, the Jews, when And when all those parties finished, maybe they started to miss those parties. So the story of Haman started. So that made them do a big teshuva. That made them do a big comeback to Hashem. And then HaKadosh Baruch Hashem, He helped them. They did a big teshuva. They started to study Torah. They started to do a mitzvot. Then Kibu v'kiblu. Did they start really to do a big teshuva? They know that it's finished. No one can help him. Then they heard that Esther, she married Achashverosh, and she could even help them. So they said, that's it. It's the end of us. If even the Jews, the Esther, she cannot help us, that's it. It's finished. But still, they did a big teshuva. They said to them, at least, if we have to die, we die with a big teshuva, with a teshuva. And then HaKadosh Baruch Hu gave a big miracle. He did a big miracle. And they were saved. And they did, when they punished their enemies, on the day that the enemy is supposed to kill them, they did not touch at their money. They wanted to show Achashverosh what is important for us. It's that we are alive to do Torah mitzvot. We don't want money. Baruch Hashem, the best money we have is the Torah. We want you to spend time studying Torah, to do Torah mitzvot. Kimu v'kiblu. They started to do Torah mitzvot. And they started to take compromise. They started to do compromise. Kimu v'kiblu. They said to compromise to themselves what they should do. How they act, how they should keep their Judaism. That's why every year we do this. Every year we do Purim. Every year we do Purim. Today, there is a family here in Paris that will do a big Purim. You know why? Beside the man who won back his house, but there is another man who will do a big Purim today. This Purim, a big family. Last Sunday, it was a gala, a banquet, to collect money for a school here in Paris. So I was the guest of honor. So at the beginning, it was a little bit, because as you know, there is a crisis, and besides this, there is a lot of banquets, tzedakah banquets here in France. So I spoke. I give a speech that this school, it's a very good school, and we should help the school, we should do... And I said, well, you know, 2 weeks it's Purim, and Hashem, he shout to the Jews how much he loved them, how much he care of them, and then the Jews, they shout to Hashem how much they love him, and they prove to Hashem that all what they wanted is now to receive the Torah, to accept Torah, to do Torah mitzvot, and they don't care about the money. And they did not touch at the money. So I told them, you see, we have to show now to Hashem that we don't care about the money, or what is the future of our children. The Jewish education that we give, this school, we must help. And I said, Be'ezat Hashem, anyone who take the opportunity to give a good amount of money, HaKadosh Hashem will do a nes, a miracle, the same miracle that Hashem did to the Jews in Persian. So people, they start to come. 2,000 euros, 3,000 euros, 7,000 euros. And there's a man who came, a rabbi. He said, I don't have enough money, but you said that if we have the school, so Hashem will give us, will help us, and will do miracles with us. So I want to give this amount of money, quite a good amount. So I was so proud of him. I said, you see, you have emunah on Hashem. Thank you. Thank you, I said to him. And then the next day it was the bris of my grandchild. And I saw that man, that rabbi, who was there among the guests. He said, you know, Rabbi, I'm supposed to travel this morning to Belgium. And I decided not to travel. I decided to come to enjoy you, the bris of your grandchild. And I said, well, anyway, you said yesterday, last night you said that Hashem will do miracles for us. So, I believe in Hashem. I was happy. I said, thank you for coming. Thank you. Four hours later, the news came all over France, all over the world. Two trains in Belgium collapsed. There were over 20 people killed and 50 or 60 people very badly injured. It was shocking. People were asked. It was shocked. It was on Monday. Last Monday. And that man, that rabbi, he came to see me. He said, Rabbi, I was supposing to travel this morning to Belgium and to arrive at 9:30 to Belgium and to change one of those trains that they collapsed to go to the country for the Hashgacha to supervise milk. And because of you, because of the breeze, I didn't go. And I was supposed to be in that wagon where there were 20 people killed. That means we could be 21 people killed. Me with them. Thank you, Hashem. He said, this is a miracle. I give yesterday a donation and Hashem did a miracle with me that I will not travel. I will not go. If I would go, I'm sure I'll get killed. I'll die in the accident. You see how Hashem, this story, all Paris talk about this story. That happened not thousands of years ago, that happened last Monday. My friend, this is Hashem. When you have emunah on Hashem, when you rely only on Him, parnasa, getting married, everything, you need nothing. The problem is when the person you want to feel, I'm the boss, I'm the barabait. I, you, who are you? You're nothing. This is the problem, my friend. I would like just to finish with a small story. And this story is a very well-known story. Haman, that he wanted to kill the Jews. Even his children knows the end of the story. The Jews were not killed, and it was Haman who got killed. And up to now we do Purim to remember that Jews, they should remain together. Should remain strong and emunah on Hashem. And we have to keep ourselves, to keep our Judaism. And if we start, God forbid, to do bad things, it's not related to the Judaism. So that means that maybe you may lose your Judaism. Maybe it could be dangerous for you. So Hashem, sometimes He reminds us, hey, I'm here. Don't forget, I'm watching you. You want to leave me? You want to leave? I will not let you. sometimes we think, well, what mistakes I made? What's wrong? Why this? It's nothing. This is nothing. Of course, if we talk that language, if everyone he will say, this is nothing, this mitzvah is nothing, this is nothing, I'm Jewish, it's okay, I'm a good tradition, I'm okay. If we don't work hard to keep our Judaism, and we permit to ourselves to live a light Jewish life, so then the more it is light, the more it will become more lighter. Then at the end, we will not feel at all the Judaism. Bemeta, in front of, next to me, I went somewhere in the plane, there was a man who told me, are you going to X, to this city? I said, well, I'm flying there, like you, with you. He said, so you are the Rabbi Pinto. I said, how do you know? He said, well, I heard of you, I saw your pictures, I saw a video, I heard of you. Good. Okay. And he started to talk to me in Hebrew. So it's like he wanted to show me that he's Jewish. So I said, I told him, I prefer you talk to me in English, because I don't understand your Hebrew. He said, I want a bracha. I want a blessing. I said, okay, what blessing do you need? I'm not married. I want to find a good girl, a good Jewish wife. Very good, what else? I want a good parnasa. I said, I think, Baruch Hashem, you have a good parnasa. He said, yes, but I want more parnasa, I want more. Okay? And I told him, a man like you with Baruch Hashem, with a lot of money, it's easy for you to find a good girl. He said, but I want a good girl, a good Jewish girl. Because now I go out with non-Jewish girls, but I want a good Jewish girl. I said, what about if you don't find a good Jewish girl? So he said, well, if I don't find, I don't find. So maybe I will marry a non-Jewish girl, but if I find, give me a bracha. I said, okay, I give you the bracha. And we entered the plane. We were two seats. He was one seat behind me. I was with somebody. And then they started to give food. And I said to the one to my secretary, maybe this man, he did not order kosher food. Maybe in front of us, he will not dare to eat Air France food. Maybe he will have a problem. So we will give him our food. We have enough sandwich. My secretary said, okay. And then they started serving food. And they served him the first, l'aperitif. It was not kosher, of course. And he ate it. Said to my secretary, maybe he doesn't know what it is, maybe he thinks it's, maybe, well, let's wait for the real food. So then they started to give food, he did not refuse. And he started eating. So I looked at him, I said, hi, bon appétit. And he answered me, thank you, Rabbi. And he carried on eating. I said to him, you want this nice plate, nice kosher food? No, thank you. I like this. This is good food. It's not kosher, but it's good. I was very proud of that man. at least is not hypocrite. Today people are hypocrite. Sometimes there will be some people that in front of a rabbi they will not eat. But when they are not with the rabbi, they say the rabbi they will do the worst sin that it's impossible to believe that he can do it. At least this man is not hypocrite. I was proud of him and I blessed him again. He doesn't know. He doesn't know. Maybe he will know now that he has to be careful. You see, God forbid, how this man, it happened that he eat not kosher food even in front of the rabbi. He would have bracha on one hand. He want to get married to a Jewish one, but he eat not kosher. How? Because he doesn't know. He doesn't know. Because his parents did not teach him. But Baruch Hashem, he's looking for a Jewish woman. But if he doesn't find, he will marry somebody that is not Jewish. Because he doesn't know. At least he's looking. I hope, Be'ez Hashem, he will find. So you see, to keep a Judaism, it's not through tradition. Tradition, that means what they did, I do. La tradition. No. You have to create your own obligation. To feel that without the Torah, you are nothing. Without Hashem. You have to feel this connection to Hashem, with Hashem. I would like to tell you something incredible. I was in Lyon last week. And I went to wish Mazel Tov to somebody that he did the Bar Mitzvah of his son. I arrived to the house. There is a big dog. But he tied the dog that he would not jump on me. And I enter. And when he saw the dog that the balabai, the owner of the house was talking to me, was kissing me, so the dog was happy, he was happy, and I started to swatch the dog. And I said to myself, look, this dog, how he's happy to see his boss. Millions of times a day he will show to his boss happiness. Even that the dog, he was tied in his neck with a string and he was jumping with happiness, just that the dog, that the balabai, his boss, will have a little bit of attention on him. The food was on the floor. It was raining. Dirt was unclean. He was happy. I said to myself, a little bit of attention, a little bit of food that the owner of the dog gives to his dog, the dog, he will dive for his boss. And Hashem, He give us life, money, women, children, everything, Baruch Hashem. And we are free. We are not tied through the neck. How many thanks we should thank Hashem? And we are not a dog. We are human being. We are not animal. Look this animal the way. Recognize all the good things that the dog, that the balabai, that the boss is doing for him. What about us? So that hurts Hashem. With all what he's doing with us, and we don't keep Torah mitzvot, it's hurting. So Hashem, sometimes he do something that to wake you up, to wake us up. course, there will be some people who will agree with me, and there will be some people who will not agree with me. But I'm sorry if I hurt somebody. This is the way. It's not easy to be Jew, and easy to lose the Judaism. To keep the Judaism is not easy. It's very hard. But all of us, we want to remain Jew. We're happy to be Jew. So there is conditions. Otherwise, could be problems. We could lose our tradition, our Judaism, everything. I was in Los Angeles a few years ago, and I saw an old woman. She came to me. She's not married. She lost her husband, and she was crying. She told me, "Rabbi, help me." I said, "How can I help you?" She said, "When we came from Poland 45 years ago, or 50 years ago, we were Orthodox. And then in America, we started to lose our Judaism. Today, I'm the only one left." It's so sad. I have no one in my family. They're all, some of them are not married, some of them are married, not Jewish. It's finished. No kippur. Finished. We're lost. There was nobody to take care of us. So our father was very ill, shocked. He lost all his family. No synagogue, no kasher. Then, here we are now. He said, "I saw you." And it reminded me my grandfather. And she showed me the picture of her grandfather. I said, "Madame, it's not too late. Come back. Come back." Hashem, he remained Hashem. He's there always. Well, my friend, this is Purim. Purim is the joy, happiness. What is this happiness? Mishinechnas Adar, Mabim Simcha. Adar is from the word Dira. Dira is the house. When a man has a house, he's happy. When a man has no house, he's not happy. But Baruch Hashem, what is this? Our house is the Torah. The Torah, Ve'asuli Mishkan, Ve'shachanti Bitocham. What Hashem wants for us to build a house. A house of Torah. And we live in this house. It's hard at the beginning. But slowly, by slowly, Mishinichnas, just enter this house, enter the Torah, enter to the Torah, start to the religion, start to the Torah mitzvot. Ta'amu u'kitov Hashem. At the beginning, it's very, very hard. But after, little by little, you will see the pleasure of the Torah. Nothing else. There is nothing that can give you pleasure than the Torah Kiddushah. The Holy Torah. Give it a chance. Give a chance to the Torah. Give a chance to the mitzvot. You will see how good it is. Mishinichnas Adar, Mabim Bisimcha. This is the real joy. And Baruch Hashem, thanks God. It was so hard. It was so difficult what our parents passed through in Poland, Auschwitz, everywhere. All kinds of programs in the world. Baruch Hashem, Am Yisrael, hi. We're still here, Baruch Hashem. We're still here, Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem, we're still here. This is a big ness. This is a big ness. Of course, unfortunately, what happened in the Shoah, 6 million Jews, maybe more, I have no answer for that. I was in Auschwitz, and I saw Auschwitz. I saw the camp. I saw. And I cried. I prayed there. And I said at the beginning to Hashem, "Why? Where were you?" The same accusation as everybody accused Hashem. Where? Why? Why? But suddenly, I saw all my group with me. I said, "Baruch, thank you, Hashem. Thank you. Am Yisrael Hai. Baruch Hashem, we still remain. We're still here." This is the Koach of Hashem. Of course, on one hand, look what happened, but for that I have no answer. I have no answer. But Baruch Hashem, I have only one answer. I am here. We are here. Baruch Hashem, we are here. We have Torah, mitzvot. This is the only way to keep ourselves keeping going. This is very important. This is a very important what I'm telling you. Very important what I'm telling you. Between you and me. What happened exactly? I saw the camp. There is. Once upon a time there were there 100,000 Jews. 100,000 Jews. How many policemen, how many soldiers they were there? A few hundred. Why there was no revolution there? Why they didn't burn the camp? Why the Jews didn't burn the camp? Why we have to accuse America or England? Why they didn't bombard the camp? But why the Jews that they were there, why they didn't burn it? Why didn't they run? What happened? How this Mangano, this man, he was with his hand, he was killing people or everything, life of the people was in his hand. This is for death, this is for life. What happened? Trains came with thousands of people. Why did it do a revolution? Why? The Nazis were at war. Most of the armies were at war. Why those Jews didn't do no revolution? You see, my friend, there is no answer. Even for that, there is no answer. There is only one answer. For the Jews that remained alive, we are here, Baruch Hashem. Every generation, there is a Haman, there is a Hitler, there is somebody who wants to finish with the Jews. V'chol dor v'dor amdim alenu lechalotenu v'akosh v'orchu matzinu miyedav. Every Pesach, we said, in every generation, there is always somebody who wants to kill the Jews. Who wants to find that solution, because it's like, I don't know why. Maybe we don't have a good face, I don't know. Why? But one thing is clear. But they tried and they don't succeed. They cannot do it. Never. Am Yisrael Chai. We're here. Till Mashiach comes, Be'et Hashem. So you see, the Nes of Purim, it reminds us what happened in Purim, it will happen every year, every generation, every 40 years, every 100 years. But it will finish like it finished in Purim. Just we have to, it's a reminder, we have to remind ourselves not to lose our Judaism. It's like we sleep and the alarm wake you up. Those people who want to find us, a finest solution for us, you should know that they will never find the solution. Because Einenu Einu Vinishan Shomer Israel. We say the tefillah every day. Hashem, he doesn't sleep. He's awake. He's watching. He's watching. We do Torah mitzvot. We have nothing to fear. Be'ezat Hashem. So my friend, now that we understand the miracle of Purim, Be'ezat Hashem, this miracle, believe me, it's not only a miracle, but it's not only a story, but it's a miracle that it repeats it at himself every generation. So, Be'ezat Hashem, I wish to all of you, Chag Sameach, Purim Sameach, God bless you, and I wish you well, and I see you, Be'ezat Hashem. Take care.